But he has got... Hello. I love you, but I need to shoot a video. Hey everyone, Chris from Rekombu here, and you might think that because it's just a few days before Christmas, our work as mobile phone reviewers might actually be done. But sadly not so much, because EE has got other ideas. It's just launched the EE Hawk. It's a new affordable phone, and you can buy it right now from EE stores here in the UK and online, of course. 150 quid SIM free, or from £15 a month on EE's contracts. So definitely a strong rival to the likes of the Moto G5 and the rest of that. So let's go check out the specs, give it a full unboxing and get it set up and see what you can expect. Right, so first of all, the Hawk box kind of reminds me a bit of a shoebox. I'm not really sure why that is. Maybe it's got all this random stuff on the side, and it's that grey colour, which is kind of not particularly exciting, just reminds you of like smart school shoes or whatever. But of course, it's not the box itself that's interesting, it's what's inside the box. So let's check that out. So here is the EE Hawk in a nice little sheath. We will check that out in full in a second. We're just going to have a look at the contents of the rest of the box. First of all, as it is an unboxing, of course. So of course, you get a pin porky device in order to stick a SIM card in there, always handy. And if we pull this open, there should just be like a quick start warranty guide type thing. Yeah, quick start guide, user warranty info, yada yada. So yeah, highly exciting literature. Of course, you get a 3-pin plug. Why not? There you go, nice bit of EE branding on there. It's full Type-C USB as well, so of course you get Type-C USB charger cable too, so that's lovely. And also, one of the more intriguing inclusions is the fact that you get a pair of JBL earphones in the box as well, which is a nice little bonus addition. And yeah, actually, they look all right. They have the nice soft tip in-ear efforts, and you do actually get some bonus rubber buds as well, so depending on how massive or tiny your lug holes are, they should fit nicely. And of course, it is 3.5mm jack, which you will find on the EE Hawk, so good news for anyone who's a fan of the old wired cables, old school. All right, we'll just chuck all of that away and off to the side for now, and let's actually have a look at the phone itself. So this is the EE Hawk, as well you can see. So it's a 5-inch smartphone. We'll go through all of the specs in detail in a bit. You just want to get the sheath stuff off. Right, okay, it looks like there's not one on the back. As you can see, it's a nice glossy finish here on the rear end. So it's kind of like a glass and metal style finish. Is it metal or plastic? I'll have to look that up, to be honest. It feels pretty rugged though. EE did big that up as one of its sort of its main strengths, is the fact that it's a very rugged smartphone, so you can bang it about the place and hopefully shouldn't show any signs of wear and tear anytime soon. It's not fully water resistant, of course, as you can expect at this price point, but at the very least it should be able to just be chucked into a rucksack or something like that and bandied around without any damage. Good news if you're going to give it to your kids or something like that. As you can see around the back there, you get a fingerprint sensor mounted right in the center. You get a slightly jutting rear camera lens as well. It's a 13 megapixel effort with two-tone LED flash and a nice bit of EE branding there as well. And let's see if we've got any juice in the tank while we take it to the rest of the hardware. There we go, buzz. Brilliant, there we go. Powered by Android, of course. It is full Android Nougat. We'll take a little bit of a tour of the interface. You can see that for yourself. Around this side, you've got power button and two volume buttons. Up top, of course, you've got that 3.5mm jack, which is always good. You get a SIM card and micro SD memory card tray here on the left edge. And then down below, you get the two speakers mounted there on the bottom edge, and of course the Type-C USB charging port, so you can power it back up. So because it's got a bit of power in there, let's actually have a run around the interface, check out exactly what you can expect. So first of all, it is of course running full Android Nougat. So if we dive down to the About phone, there you go, Nougat 7.0, so quite a basic back in the day version. It's around about a year old now. But hopefully it'll get updated to 7.1 and full-on Oreo in the near future. It seems to be quite a stock version of Android, meaning that EE hasn't played around with it much. It looks like it's basically Android as you would expect it if you got it fresh from Google, with just a few bonus apps on there. So for instance, if we dive into the apps tree, you can see, of course, you get My EE, which basically just gives you a quick overview of how much of your account allowances that you've used for the month, how much data you've used, minutes, all that kind of stuff. Shows you exactly when your next bill's due, all that kind of thing. So it's quite handy to have if you're an EE customer, which of course you should be if you bought the Hawk. And a few little bonus bits like Lookout, which just helps to keep your phone nice and secure. Make sure you don't get any nasty malware on there. WPS Office, if you want to do a bit of word processing on the go on your handset, why not? And besides that, it is basically your stock Android. So if you dive into the settings, you can see exactly what you can expect. The usual Android settings. Don't want to display. It's a 5-inch display, 720p HD. It's got this mirror vision feature on it. Remember trying to test that out before, not really seeing any real difference, to be honest. It seems like your perfectly standard, bog standard budget display, to be honest. Because it's 720p HD, it's not quite as sharp as some of its rivals, such as the Moto G5, but if you get in nice and close, you'll struggle to notice any individual pixels, to be honest. It certainly seems reasonably crisp. HD video and the likes of YouTube and everything will look absolutely fine. Not the most vibrant of screens, as far as I can tell. Viewing angles, certainly a bit of an issue as well. The likes of color and contrast certainly drop off as you start to tilt the screen, but it's a minor complaint considering, again, it is a budget handset. Certainly, it seems to be really, really bright on top brightness. Yep. Oh yeah, look at that. Wow. If that is not blinding you right now through your monitor, then I don't know what will, to be honest. You'll be able to see everything super clearly on that, even if you're in, you know, Barbados or somewhere like nice and sunny, not the UK basically. So no worries there whatsoever. Back into the Android settings, and let's see what else we can find. So storage, you get 16 gigs of storage as standard, but as you can see, not much of that is actually available, roughly 9 gigs. To begin with, quite a lot of it's already been taken up by those apps I just mentioned, and of course the Android OS. Thankfully, there is micro SD memory card support, so you can slot in a memory card. I'm not sure what the maximum size of card is that you can slot in, but generally it's at least 32, so you should be able to fit quite a lot of media and bits on there if you need to. It's always handy. What's actually powering it as well? It's a Mediatek processor. It's the Mediatek 6750, running at 1.5 gigahertz. So it's quite, again, a basic platform, but so far, touch wood, everything seems to be running okay. Maybe a slight delay as you're waiting for some apps to load, but overall, considering it's a budget blower, it seems to be handling life reasonably well. It's got 2 gigs of RAM backing it up, which is the minimum you kind of want with Android these days. We've seen a few phones with just 1 or 1.5, some of the Nokia low-end handsets come to mind on that one, and they kind of run like a dead slug, I guess, for want of a better analogy. Not very well at all. Whereas TouchWord, it seems to be doing the job, so hopefully it will stand the test of time and sort of provide a reasonably satisfying experience. As for the battery tech, it's a 2,500 mAh battery. If you dive into the battery settings, you get your basic options in there from Android. So you get intelligent power saving standby, which is quite good. Basically just ditches some of those features that you don't need when the phone is hibernating. So you'll still get your notifications through and everything, but it'll cull some of the other stuff. You can check out your battery percentage right there on the notifications tab up top. And you've also got a battery saver mode as well, which just culls some of those non-essential features if you're desperate for that last bit of juice. And because it's 2,500 mAh, we're expecting probably a day of use, day of pretty demanding use per charge. And then you can, of course, charge it up via Type-C at night when you want to. Which brings us finally onto the camera tech. So you get a 13 megapixel rear camera. It's going to be a pretty, again, bog standard basic one, no doubt. As you can see, pretty straightforward, streamlined interface. You can just take a quick button, quick photo with this. Oh God. You can take a quick photo with just a tap of the shutter button, like so. Of course, you've got your two-tone LED flash to light things up. And you can switch to video mode as well and stop recording a video at any time. Let's just stop that. If we dive into the settings, we should be able to see. So I'm expecting it to max out at HD video recording. Let's just dive into here. It actually doesn't say, it just says video quality high best. So yeah, I'm guessing that'll be 720p HD video if you go on to the best. As you can see, you've got some basic image stabilization on there as well. We'll see how good that is. I'm not expecting it to rock my world, but I'm sure it'll be absolutely fine. Dive into the photo, you see you've got likes of anti-shake that just helps to crop out if your hand's a bit trembly. If it's low light, you know, sometimes the shutter has to stay open a little bit longer, help to remove any blur. capture number, so you can do a bit of burst shot mode. Picture size, as you can see, 13 megapixels is the max, and you can check out some other little basic features such as the ISO levels. And of course, you've got the likes of fierce beauty mode. Why wouldn't you? Good old beauty mode. See where the photos are actually stored, and you can actually play around with the likes of white balance and the rest as well. So that's pretty good if you want a bit of manual control to try and get a very exact kind of shot. You've got a couple of other little bonus features here. So you've got pit modes, which basically makes you look like you're on a Polaroid for some reason. Yeah, and it just shoots you and whatever's in front of you. So kind of like a dual shot feature on the Nokia 8. You also get a panorama modes, and of course your bog standard shooting mode. So it's a very streamlined, very cut down, basic set of camera features. And you know what, that's absolutely fine. Of course, the usual filters too, hooray. And if you swap to the front facing camera, it's an 8 megapixel front facer. So it should prove absolutely fine for your selfies and the rest. So there you have the EE Hawk, 150 quid, as I say, available now. Doesn't really seem to do anything particularly novel or stand out compared to the competition like the Moto G5, which of course does have a full HD screen, which definitely seems nicer than this one. But you know what, if you can get a good deal through EE, particularly with a good bit of data and everything on it, then that should do the job quite nicely. Certainly a good handset potentially for kiddie winks, or maybe as even as a secondary handset if you're feeling a bit flash. So there you go. Any questions, comments, anything like that, let us know in the comments below. And thanks for watching, everyone. Ta-ta.